Thundergrunt.
I've seen things you people wouldn't believe.
Attack ships on fire off the shoulder of Orion.
I watched sea beams glitter in the dark near the Tannhauser Gate.
All those moments will be lost in time.
Like tears in rain.
Time to die.
Ship in the center of Mars was a sack of souls from experiment scars. When the second of the monk said, I'll take two, and he put them in a rocket and he ate a lot of glue. And he shot them to Earth, and they turned into babies. They were named Bob and Matt, and they really got rabies. And the monk made a movie of their whole entire lives. They were panoramic scenes and zooms of the thighs. And one time Bob had sex with a ladle, and one time Matt left a vet to a cradle, and another time Bob caught a dinosaur mom, and another time Matt bought a replica of Guam. And all this more is on a DVD set, only $20.99 with the purchase of a gem. But if you call right now and say, where's my whisk? We'll include this
bonus disc.
Hey! Ah! Welcome to bonus disc!
Okay, hello.
Matt, smile.
I am.
You can hear it in your voice when you smile.
Yeah. See, I'm smiling.
Thank you, Matt, the host of the show.
Whatever.
I'm Bob Rose, and with me and Matt is returning favorite Kathy Carson. Hi,
hello.
Kathy.
Hi.
The last time you were on, we reviewed a new release movie.
It's true.
She should have had a sort of a like an apology episode because... That wasn't a real episode.
It really wasn't a real episode.
That movie was shitty, though.
That movie was
so
shitty.
It was a shit movie, but yeah, like, Kathy, you kind of never had a regular bonus disc, so this is sort of an apology. We gave you the regular experience.
Hey, man.
Yeah.
Which is watching a movie from somewhere around 1985
to 2005. She got the premium experience. We just ate ice cream. No one has ever eaten ice cream on this show before.
That's true. Did she pay for it, though?
I did.
She paid for her own ice cream.
I paid for my own ice cream.
So we gave her the opportunity to go buy ice cream. Yes. All right,
just because I'm female doesn't mean I can't pay for my own ice cream.
Right, well, you're one of those.
I'm one of
those. We'll get to that, though.
We're going to get to it. We watched a movie that is not the movie from Tropic Thunder that is called Scorcher, starring Mark Dacascos.
That guy... In another world, he's like Tom Cruise.
Did you ever
like,
see?
No lie, dude.
No.
He can do a good job, and
yeah,
he's
he
really good in action.
Did you see Brotherhood of the Wolf?
Yes.
So
I saw
good.
That in theaters.
It's all French awesome. With subtitles, and he is like the companion of this French explorer who's like come back from America, I think. And he's come back to France.
Sounds like a good movie.
And yeah, and there's like there's
we're
some
not
kind
allowed
of creature.
To talk about it, Kathy.
There's some kind of creature.
Yeah, you're breaking protocol. We can't talk about anything good.
You know what? We're not sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, this is a bad movie, or I guess this is an entertaining movie.
It's pretty awful.
It's
though.
A movie.
It's
let's
like
say that.
Two bad movies
no,
in one.
It's five movies.
Yeah, it's like
it's
a
kind
lot
of five
different.
Movies. So it's called Scorcher.
Literally, it's five different
It's called
movies.
Scorcher. It's from 2002. And the only reason I'm going to say that really is because Ted from Scrubs is in it. And none of us could place when that is.
Yes.
Because Scrubs kind of felt like it existed forever for a long time.
Yeah.
It kind of dominated Comedy Central forever. Remember that?
It was weird.
Yeah. But Ted's in it, and he plays a guy named Fingers. Anyway.
I remember I once was like, why the fuck did I ever buy a season of Scrubs on DVD when it's
just
on TV? Because
they
just
keep playing
them
over and over again.
Yeah. It's kind of just on. How many seasons did it have? It doesn't matter. Anyway, Scorcher. Scorcher, the movie that is many movies.
Yes. There's a secret movie hidden in this movie that they didn't even know.
We're
going
to get to it, but it's probably
my
favorite
part. Yeah,
no,
it's the best part of the movie. It's amazing.
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah.
And
without
it's small
a doubt.
And it's insignificant.
Yeah, in the end, it has absolutely no consequence to
yes.
anything
but it's
else.
So good.
It's...
They missed it. Like, how did
they miss
it? Like, whizzed right by him. It's like a joke that went over their
and
heads.
And it could
they
still
understand.
Be called Scorcher, and it would have been,
it's been a
honestly,
better movie.
Honestly, a perfect title for that for that
for
small
that movie.
Yeah.
For this movie that isn't that movie, not a perfect title.
No.
Nothing gets scorched.
Well, but there's a lot of firestorms.
There's one fire. There's a firestorm.
Antarctica is on fire.
Well, there's
people.
That, yes.
Yeah.
That is the opening
shot.
It's
not a storm, though. It's more like a...
It's just like fields of
fire. That is the opening
fire.
Shot. Here we go. We're in the opening shot. We see...
Rhys-Davies in a parka.
Okay, so I didn't realize that was him.
That
right
was
away.
Him, yeah. That was Gimli. Right.
Yeah. Well, like, okay, so there's supposed to be an Antarctica. It's, like, supposed to be... Oh, like but I guess since it's on fire, it's not as
well,
cold.
Well, the reveal isn't yet, because they're walking up to, like, a hill in Antarctica to see what's happening, right? Like,
yeah.
That's all we know.
Yeah, because they don't explain shit. They, like, climb over an icy mountain, and then everything's... lava and fire.
And like,
right.
And he's like, it's worse than I thought. And then it just goes to the next scene.
Right.
Which is Mark Dacascos in the helicopter with fingers.
Yes. And he's being all crazy.
That was Ted from Scrubs.
Yes.
He's supposed to be like Jacques from Raiders of the Lost Ark. You know what I mean? Like the crazy buddy that like he's just ready to go. Like
He's supposed to be the comic relief.
Yeah.
Yeah. He says man and stuff like he's like a drug addict.
You know what he reminded me
His
of?
Name is
Philip
Fingers.
Seymour Hoffman from Twister.
Yes. Yeah! Yes.
Like,
Dusty.
He was the Dusty of this movie.
Yes.
Yeah.
He had a weird, like, southern accent, I guess.
Dude, he just was weird, man. Yeah, there was no direction on that. It was just be funny.
And so then he's a pilot. He's flying a helicopter.
Right. And Mark Dacascos is, like, doing this thing where he, like, he just always has these zingers. Like, no matter what the dude says, he's like, I see some donkeys down there. And Mark Dacascos is like, we're not talking about your sex life or something. Yeah.
I like the way you said it. We're not talking about your sex life. I don't remember him saying it like that, but
like, yeah, I remember screaming it over a helicopter.
Over a helicopter microphone. Right, yeah.
But he's talking about how he's about to retire.
Right.
And Fingers is like, hey, what are you retiring for? And he's just like, because I want to, what did he say? I want to buy a house on a beach and grow something or some shit.
Oh, and like, what was watch it? His daughter grow?
Oh, buy a bunch of kites.
Buy a bunch of kites.
He's like, I'm going to buy a house on a beach and buy a bunch of kites.
He's like 32 years old.
Yeah,
too.
He's not old, man.
He's not old at all.
He's a colonel.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. He's not exactly
like... That's about
like,
to retire.
Yeah.
You're right.
Whatever, okay?
But yeah, buy a bunch of kites. Oh, and then he's like, my daughter likes to surf. She never surfs.
His daughter
in the movie.
Is not a human being. She's like a cardboard cutout of a person.
Honestly, at that point, I was like, man, are we going to see like a lava surfing scene? You know what
John,
I mean?
That would have been so good.
Yeah. If they're going to steal from Escape from LA,
but they are.
One up it with lava instead of water.
So he's flying over an island that's, I guess, the island
it's
from
like
the
Pompeii.
Beach. Yeah.
No, it is the island
from
the beach because it's stock footage from the Leonardo DiCaprio movie. As we learned in the credits.
Yeah.
In the credits, there's clips from the beach.
Dante's Peak
Dante's
and
Peak.
Daylight, the Stallone
Daylight.
Movie. Daylight.
And,
which is perfect sense because there's a scene in we'll get to it.
And then
yeah.
they, it also said they stole effects from Terminator 2.
Right.
They
took effect shots and put it over other shots. This movie looks like hell. It's amazing.
Yeah,
everything's like... red with a blue background.
Oh my God.
And all the effects are like atrocious.
Oh yeah.
God
the nuclear
damn it.
Oh wait. Should we
we're flying over the mountain.
Flying over the mountain.
There's a volcano erupting, and he's like,
yeah, that's
a volcano. I'm a fucking hot shit motherfucker, and I'm just dropping into this volcano. Dude, he doesn't give a fuck. They're flying into a volcano that's erupting. It's just people like running for their lives.
And he's just
getting
like,
destroyed
joking.
By chunks of rock. And he's like, yeah, whatever. Rolls into the woman's house, and she's like, oh, Data. And he's just like, what's up, girl?
Yes,
I crept up
like,
on you like a
he's
creep.
This is what
her.
A life of kitesmanship does to you.
That's why I need those kites.
Kites, they relax you
but
in a situation.
I don't know what anything is.
Like,
I need to do something boring for once.
So he helicopters
like
in to
gauge.
Save that stupid lady, and she's like, I'll go when I'm ready. And he's like,
dude, it showed lava hitting the edge of the fucking building.
There is
outside.
A window next to them that has fire actively burning in it.
And she's like, no, I'll leave whenever I want to.
And then he's like,
get the fuck out of there,
you've
lady.
Got a helicopter.
But But then that's what he says. That's what he says. Oh, you're one of those.
But while he's looking at her ass.
Oh, yes. He's looking at her ass.
It's a shot of her ass.
He's been hitting on her as soon as. That's what I'm saying. He's so flippant. It's insane. There's lava pushing against the wall of the building. And he's like, yeah, what's up, girl?
It's time to mac.
You want
to
get on a helicopter with me and fly away?
She's like, no, the data.
I got a magic carpet. Right. It's right outside.
It's just like.
I did. Come on. It's not the Koskis' fault.
No, no.
It's not.
It's what it's written to be, but it's just like, God. It's terrible.
Yeah, it's bad.
But it's pretty bad.
They do get in the helicopter.
Well, no.
Well, they get in the car.
Eventually, they get into a truck.
They get into a truck. That's the Dante's
driving
Peak stuff.
Yes. So that's where they have. Yeah. That's where they stole footage from Dante's Peak. Because while we were watching it, Kathy was like, there's a scene just like this in Kathy.
That's insane, though, because Kathy did say there's a scene just like this in Dante's Peak.
There is.
Peak.
They're driving through this like village.
You
while
were watching a scene from Dante's Peak.
That's so good.
But in Dante's Peak, the piece of like. The piece of whatever that comes through the top of the truck at the last minute, and it's like a big deal.
It actually goes through
and it goes through the lady's head, and like, what's his name?
Pierce Brosnan.
Pierce Brosnan's like holding her and like crying and driving.
It hits the front side. No, but dude, it like flattens one side of the car and it keeps moving like nothing happened.
Yeah, and, no, it flattens just where the engine should be, but now it's like flat and you're like, well, why is it moving?
Yeah.
What's propelling that
it's
thing?
Whatever.
And that scene in
matter.
Dante's Peak, that's the beginning of the movie. And then it comes to like 5 years later and he's like, a broken man. Like, living in
from
filth.
Volcanoes. Yes. Sadly, we're not watching Dante's
Peak. Stop talking about good movies!
I don't know if I'd say Dante's Peak was a good
It's at least watchable. Like, it's generally...
I'm kind of upset there was no volcano footage in this.
Yeah.
Right?
Where was that?
A subway, even. There's a subway in this movie.
No lava.
No volcano lava footage.
That must have been a different movie company.
I want to see...
Were those all, like, Universal films?
They had to be, or something
because
like that.
Because there's no way they were like,
yeah,
we're going
to
pay
sure
money
Daylight's
to get...
Universal. This must have been owned by a sub-company of Universal.
Yeah.
It has to be.
So there's probably... That movie's a different movie
company.
Man,
you just reminded me, though, she said that. That is... fucking hilarious. That you said there's a scene in Dante's Peak just like this.
It's amazing.
It is.
You're right. Just all the insert shots, you know, Mark Dacascos and this woman who's trying to like jump out of the car.
There's people
dying everywhere.
And she's
like,
trying to get out and he punches her and knocks her out.
He hits on her, basically tells her, you know, she's one of those, which is what was that?
Whatever that means.
Then decks her.
And then kidnaps her, and then when she's like, I don't want to be with you, he punches her in the face.
Because she's being hysterical, obviously.
Well, she is a woman.
She's a woman.
And in this universe, that's what it is, apparently.
Yeah, in this universe, it's God,
you know what?
It's terrible out there.
If this movie was made, like, 15 years before, though, it would have been much worse. You know, like, all the 80s movies we watched where the sexism is, like, through the roof.
Oh, no, when you thought someone was going to get raped, they would have.
Yes.
If this was an 80s movie, and it'd be like, oh, man, it'd be sad.
Yeah, it would not be cool.
At all.
Would not be cool.
She gets her on the helicopter.
They fly away. Is that when it cuts to the president?
The president is Rutger Hauer.
Yeah. And the secretary, or the chief of the army. What the fuck is the...
Whoever, his second
the hand general.
Is G.W. Bailey, who is best known as Captain Harris from Police Academy.
So he's great.
Right. They're fine. They're just earning
they're just
a paycheck,
there.
Man.
Yeah.
They're,
like
just,
you said, like Rutger Hauer could play Donald Trump in a movie.
He looks like Donald Trump in this movie.
Yeah. It's awesome.
But like slightly classier because he had those like tortoiseshell glasses on.
His hair wasn't insane. You have to give him like an absurd amount of caffeine because he's whispering everything.
Yeah, he talks so low.
He's so heavy in the movie.
I feel like he could only do like 5 or 6 word sentences at a time. And then he had to like.
His emphysema or something.
He had to just take a breather for a minute. And then he would just walk over and like sit down somewhere or lean over a table.
The daughter's next.
Oh, wait, yeah, you're right. We cut to the subway.
Which has
no volcano footage in it. Which now I'm angry about just thinking.
She's going with her
friends. The title hasn't happened yet, right? Because that happens after he points at the map.
He points at the map. Yeah, the, okay, we didn't talk about the title sequence. Yeah. The title sequence is extremely involved. And then it's off center, which annoyed the fuck out of me. It said Scorcher, it zoomed in, but like it didn't zoom in on center.
And there was another graphic saying Scorcher on top of it. That was on center.
Because they realized they messed up the effect, the real life effect that said Scorcher. Then they just added the text on the screen.
Just cover
I mean,
that
it
up.
Makes me.
Hold on, we're going backwards and forwards here.
Can I just say that the quality of this movie, it made me, even though it said it was released in, well, I guess it would have had to been in 2000, made in 2002.
Why?
If they were borrowing from those other movies. Because it feels like maybe it was, like, older.
Oh, no, yeah, like the type of story it is, it feels like it came out when, like, Armageddon came out.
Yeah.
It feels like 96-ish.
Yeah.
If I had to guess, I would say 96 if you didn't tell me in a year.
Yeah.
But
it makes sense because it was, like, they wrote it maybe then, and then all those movies existed then, and then they made it in 2001, and then they used the footage from the movies at the time when it was written because it would fit. The tone, I guess. I'm just guessing.
Maybe.
There's no Scorcher documentary or anything. So
it's IMDb pages like empty,
blank.
Apparently.
Yeah, like I said, the cast and crew have like no credits. So.
Yeah, the Wikipedia page is just the plot of the movie.
Right. So we're not going to find that out, but that's a good guess, I would assume. Okay, so we go from him slugging her in the car, helicopter, we cut to the subway where the daughter is, and she's like, there's two of her friends and they're standing far apart. Like, I don't know why. But she's, like, eye-fucking them. It's weird.
Yeah,
it's like,
all she does is look
like,
at stuff.
She
looks
like mugging, at stuff. Yeah, she's mugging for the camera, and her, like, her mouth is always just, like, open.
A tiny bit.
Like, a little bit.
Yeah.
Like, she's just not quite sure what she's ever doing anywhere that she is.
I thought that she was going to be, like, they were going to rob something, because they were, like, you ready?
Yeah.
You know?
They made it into this big deal.
Right.
But then it seemed incredibly accessible. Like, mm-hmm. They're trying to get into the train tunnel, but it's incredibly
accessible.
They
walk through a do-not-remove gate.
Yeah, do-not-go.
Do-not-go. No entry sign.
Yeah.
And they crawl through the...
Or they go around a corner, walk down a hallway, and then they're just in some kind of huge factory underneath the city.
Yeah,
Freddy's boiler room, pretty much. A rave scene would be perfect there.
Yeah, exactly.
The rave scene would be out there.
That's right. What did you guys say? You were like, well, obviously, when the disaster happens, she's going to save a bunch of people. They're going to live down here and have a rave and start fucking.
They're going to have to repopulate the city of Los Angeles.
Yeah, so her and her two friends are just laughing and having a great time, even though nothing is happening.
Yeah.
And they go to that pipe.
And
that guy they're with knows that it goes 500 feet down.
Yeah,
exactly.
They say it goes 500 feet down.
Who's they?
Who is them? He flips a coin. It goes, all right, this, I don't understand what happens. In the movie, that pipe has a cover over it. It's like a wire.
It's torn, though. It's like got a tear in it.
Does it?
Yes.
Okay. Because he flips this coin and you don't, it didn't hit it.
No, it's like, it's a mesh, like, it's a metal mesh, but it's got a big rip in it.
I couldn't tell there was a rip in it.
Yeah, it's just really badly lit, so you can't tell that, but it's got a rip in it. Okay, and if it doesn't, it makes no sense.
Yeah, okay, that's why I was like, I don't know what's going on.
I'm basically saying that for my own sanity, because I don't know. It's got a rip in it.
Okay. Yeah, it had something, because I saw it at the end.
Well, we don't want to, yeah, well.
Okay, so, but yeah, he flips a coin down, and you never hear it hit the bottom. And earlier, the girl was like, I can't go with you guys because I need to meet my aunt here in 30 minutes. And then she, like, looks at her watch and, like, goes, doesn't say anything, which is important. Because she barely speaks. I bet she has, like, six lines.
It feels
which
like
is outrageous.
Her shit was shot later and they didn't write anything.
Yes.
Except just what happens with her to fill the time out.
Yeah, there's just no dialogue.
Yeah. Because even the other dialogue kind of felt, in that part, felt improv'd.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah,
you know what I mean. It's just
the
like
real scorch, the real
scorcher, the
yeah,
real scorcher
that guy
movie.
Was just going crazy.
Yeah. We're not gonna get to that yet. So she knows about the underground train tunnel with the 500-foot drop.
Yeah,
hole.
She runs back. Her aunt's like, I shouldn't have trusted you. And she's like, I was doing nothing.
Yeah, like, and there's like the teen angst thing. Yeah. And then that went
she's
nowhere.
She's like, well, wait till your dad hears about this. And she's like, what does it matter?
Oh, yeah.
He's never here.
He's never here. Nothing matters.
And that's when it cuts to...
Even though he's a father who was literally planning his retirement to be spent...
To be with his daughter. Because he was like, I don't spend enough time with her.
Yeah.
And... Remember when they're in the train tunnel, she like takes out her like BlackBerry thing and she's like, you guys, this is my gift from my father for e-messages. It's a wireless instant messenger.
Oh, yeah. She like explained it. It's like,
Were texts that rare in 2002?
I guess.
It's so blurry of when that was normal.
Well, I think those
I feel
bigger
like I was texting like a motherfucker
like BlackBerries
in 2004. But I got, I don't know, man.
I can imagine in 2002 saying e-message.
I feel
that sounds
like
but it's all like BlackBerries and PDFs. It's not cell phones. It's like BlackBerries and
PDFs.
So
where's that? Did we have that? We had beepers, so I guess it would make sense.
We had cell phones, definitely.
BlackBerry hung in there
for a while. In 2002.
But that was basically a beeper that could transmit text.
And email. That's, you did email with BlackBerry.
Right.
Because it had this screen that had like, you know, like shopping and, you know, those really primitive
old LED
screens.
Yeah.
But it still had like icons for shopping or music or some bullshit.
We're spending way too much time on this. It's like, yeah. It was a 2002 texting device. Yeah, That's all that mattered. An e-text.
E-messages.
An e-mail. Digital
e-message. What was it?
It was a BlackBerry. It had to be.
Oh, the phone itself was the gift.
Yes.
I thought she was saying it was her birthday and he sent her like some kind of message.
Yeah, because it was her birthday, so he sent her a birthday.
But I know what Matt's saying. The way it's presented in the movie, it sounds like the actual message itself
is the gift. I didn't understand.
Yeah.
I didn't realize the
shitty
phone was,
gift. Yeah. Him saying happy birthday. Because
she's like, yeah, he's never around. And then he sends her just a text and it's supposed to be a gift.
You know why? Because
we're
thinking now, and now everyone has a cell phone, so that's not a gift.
Yeah.
You don't give a cell phone to anybody, you know?
I didn't think about that shit at all.
It's amazing the technology discussion is. It's true. You know what? And we got to come back to it eventually.
Yep.
That's not the last of the e-text Wi-Fi messaging device.
There wasn't Wi-Fi.
There wasn't.
No.
All right.
It doesn't matter.
Magically works.
It's wireless.
Even though she's in a tunnel.
Kathy's obsessed. You don't understand.
So wait, though
how BlackBerries
work. Then the aunt and the daughter are driving home in the car, and she's like, "Your dad loves you," and she's like, "Why is he here?" And then every scene in this movie is way too serious.
Oh,
all of
like
them
really
except for the
music.
Real Scorcher guy.
I'm telling
who we'll
you,
get
man,
to.
Every scene feels like it thinks it's half an hour more into the movie than it is.
Yes,
it like we know the characters a half hour more than I do. You know,
and there was like a montage, which we're about. We're not yet. Thing.
We haven't hit the president coming in yet.
Okay.
It's after the president scene.
Well, yeah. So the president comes.
Right? That's after that. The daughter has her thing. Then the president shows up.
What's the woman's name? The woman that is one of those? The one
I
that line?
You know what I mean? I know how to say it. One of those, Mom!
The one that the line happened to.
The actress's name is Teresa Davies, but I don't remember what
her character name at all.
No.
Teresa Davies.
Oh, her name is Faith.
Faith.
Okay, Faith.
That's right, because there was that line where you got to have faith in your father or whatever, and we were like, you got to have faith, or you got to have some of yourself or whatever.
Yeah, Jesus.
And you're just like, oh, Lord.
So, okay, her.
Yeah.
Faith.
Her?
Faith, Mark Dacascos, John Rhys-Davies.
Hold on. It shows the president in the elevator before
he gets
that,
out of the
first
elevator,
of all.
Yeah.
But, however, also, they don't address the fact he punched her in the mouth, and now they're just standing
in
the war room of the Pentagon.
It's never addressed.
And they're being totally professional to each other and, talking to each other. Like,
dude, at this
happens.
Point in this world, she's probably used to things. It's terrible.
In this universe, as a woman... Apparently, you just have to be prepared for men, like strange men, just like knocking you the fuck out and being okay with that. Like,
no, thanks for doing that.
Well, I would say this scene right coming up is the one where he's kind of the most sexist.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, 100%.
Definitely.
It's awesome.
Not really.
No, this scene's really good, man.
Where they're debriefing the president?
Yeah, yeah, everything he says to him and everything the president says is amazing, because John Rhys-Davies is like, shows up and he's like, I'm the head of the science.
He's
stuff.
The best climate scientist or whatever, tectonic plate scientist. But that's what the movie's about, by the way, which haven't even.
Yeah, we're getting there now. We're here now. We're going to explain what it is. And John Rhys-Davies shows up to do it, and he's like throwing shade at Faith because she's also a climate scientist who says other stuff than he does.
She's talking out of turn, and then Mark Dacascos says, don't worry, that happens a lot, right? He says
He goes, wow, you really do this a lot. You sure do talk a lot.
But then he's like...
But he's also like saying shitty things. The president's talking to her, and he's like in her ear being like, Bullshit. What you know what I mean? Yeah. And you're like, dude, what the fuck?
What was the period joke?
That hasn't happened yet.
When...
Oh, okay.
So, John Rhys-Davies is like explaining with all this like heavy-handed science shit, and the president goes, can someone speak to me in English, please?
Oh, yeah,
please?
That's right. He cannot understand anything.
He doesn't understand
anything. Talk to me as if I was a dog.
First, it's like... Somebody say it in English, please. And then somebody kind of says it in like regular.
No, then Faith like explains it normally, and then he
like
goes,
to the point where we could understand it. Yeah. And the president of the United States is like, no,
even more,
take it down.
You're on the country, dude.
And then that's when Mark Dacascos says, "Mother Nature's time of the month."
Oh yeah.
It must be her time of the month or something.
Because, all right, so John Rhys-Davies explains that the Pacific tectonic plate has moved so much.
Holy shit.
That because there's been earthquakes and stuff in LA.
Because of pollution. They blame it on pollution. They do. I remember that.
No. This is a natural occurrence, but they're saying that the damage that we've done to the atmosphere with this is a. We'll tip it over the edge into a cataclysm.
Okay, as long as we're responsible.
Yes,
it's
our fault. This could have happened and everything would have been fine.
It's kind of not a strong message, though. It's kind of like, well, we did do something. We helped.
Think about the ending and then
we loosened the jar.
Yeah.
And the, you know.
So, God damn it.
I would love to know the actual science on if that could happen.
They say that if it moves a certain distance,
44
centimeters.
Oh yeah, then like,
and then there's nothing that can be done about all the heat and gas.
No, and then
the
mantle of the Earth will shoot up through the cracks.
Yeah, that's right. It'll be like wide.
It'll be hell.
It'll melt itself.
It's literally bleeding out because it Mother Nature's on her period.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Wow. It's true.
Yeah. So you actually wasn't.
Now we're on
Mark Dacascos' side with the whole period joke, but yeah, I don't know.
Maybe he really is a feminist.
It's not, you know?
Just treating her like an equal.
Let it happen, all natural.
He's sympathetic to her pain.
Wow. Didn't think about that. Blew my mind. But anyway.
Yeah.
So then he's like, well, then what are we going to do about it?
Well, then we have to activate.
He goes, we have to have a counter seismic, and he's like, again with the words. And then she's like, we're gonna have to nuke a place to like make a wave strong enough to stop it from moving anymore. And he's like, well, where? And John Rhys-Davies points at a map, and it's Los Angeles,
just straight
and
in
it's
the
downtown, right in the middle of downtown Los Angeles.
They're just like, we need to blow up Los Angeles.
And then Christ in heaven. This plan.
And everybody's pretty much like, okay.
Yeah, I feel like the whole decision-making process was so light.
It was a montage of people looking out of windows.
Yes.
It was the president looking out windows and Mark Dacascos looking out a window.
Really serious
and
music.
Like, and looking at maps.
There's 360-degree shots of going around people like Michael Bay shots.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like, it's so deep, you know?
It's like the part in Independence Day when like the attack is going to happen.
Yeah,
it's
right.
about to happen.
Yeah,
and like,
yeah.
But there's actual like emotional investment in that one. And this one, you're just like, wait, already?
Wait, what's happening?
Who are these people?
Yeah.
There's that guy in the control room. He just keeps...
There's that guy. Fuck that guy. There's a guy in the war room, and all you ever see is from his chin up, and it's just barely any of his face and a blue... glowy wall, and I'm just like, where is he? Who is he? Why are we looking at him? He has like six shots in the fucking movie. It's crazy.
He's anyway. Tortured, man, just like the rest of them. They're so tortured.
The everyman is part of this struggle. Yeah.
Is it after that montage or right before when there's the hallway confrontation between John Rhys-Davies and Teresa?
It's afterwards.
Because then we find out the big spoiler.
They hadn't
is
made
that,
the decision yet. And right. Yeah, they're... Yeah.
But it turns out that she is his daughter.
His daughter, because that's I totally thought that they had boned. That was the vibe that they gave off.
I actually really love that. John Rhys-Davies having like any type of sexual relationship with anyone in a movie is awesome.
Especially sure. like a girl like happen. A third his happens. Age.
Right. How weird would that be?
You'd be like, well, wait a minute.
Yeah. Because you just see more, it'd be less conventional.
You never meet the mother. They never talk about the mother.
Oh, hell no.
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 I thought, didn't he tell a story about her dying?
Did he?
No.
And we did. We fell asleep through it.
I don't remember them ever bringing up the mother. Anyway, okay. They argue. Though, oh, Jesus Christ. They don't bring up Mark Dacascos' mother either.
No.
Or daughter's mother, like his wife. Oh, she's yeah. never no. mentioned
she's
either.
She's never mentioned
because
at all.
Women don't matter.
Yes. In this universe, women are expendable and they don't matter. Yeah.
So they're only useful while they're alive. As soon as they're gone, you forget about them.
Yes.
That's why his daughter was so mad at him for not being around. He's like, but I love you. And she's like, then why aren't you here? Because once I'm gone, nobody's going to care because I'm a woman. This is all coming together.
No,
this is why we do this. Yeah. We're figuring it out. We're figuring out what was really going on.
The movie's not really about lava.
No, that's why they're barely in
the politics.
The Lewis Horowitz Foundation hates yes! women.
Who also funded Cyborg Cop 2.
The Karate Dog.
Karate Dog, which we have to do now. We're gonna, yeah, I had no idea that was a thing. That clip was out of control.
I don't know if the rest of the movie's that good.
Wow.
I don't give a fuck. I gotta see that. I got to.
Anyway. So that John Rhys-Davies and his daughter have a rivalry, scientist yes. father daughter rival. You know, like
she's
they.
Like, you just don't. You don't believe in me. And he's like, I do, but you're just not as good as me. You're a woman, I guess. Like,
yeah, pretty much. And then like,
like even though you're my favorite woman on earth, you're still not that good.
Yeah, it's still
yeah,
really.
But, you know, alternate between that and being like, oh my dear, like our memories of you are fond. You'll always be my little girl, just because I wasn't with you didn't mean I wasn't thinking about you. Like, okay.
That's a pretty good John Rhys-Davies.
Yeah. A little is foppish, but it was
no, yeah,
good.
No,
yeah,
it was better than I would have. My first yeah. attempt would have been
you
way
win.
Worse. Yeah.
Yeah. Then what happens?
They argue. Then there's the thinking about it montage. Then the president thinking goes on TV and tells.
Los
he
Angeles.
Just goes on TV gonna say, well, everybody leave Los Angeles. We're really sorry and you'll be compensated, but we gotta blow it up. And yeah, then
and everybody's like, okay.
Miraculously.
This is Los Angeles.
Los Angeles in its entirety gets emptied out in about 4 to 5 hours.
Dude. It would be.
You couldn't even get home from work to pack a bag in 4 to 5 hours.
It would be the second. The president said we're gonna blow up Los Angeles. That place would turn into the Purge instantly.
Yeah. Yeah,
it'd be insane.
Everything would have been robbed. Yeah. People would have been beaten to death.
It'd be like
so
nuts.
Many gunfights.
Immediately.
It would be immediate. Like, now if it happened. It's like it's Los Angeles.
It's full of lunatics.
This, they showed news footage in this movie that was just 5 a.m. to 5 p.m. traffic.
Yeah.
It's like that's not a chaos at all.
It's the concepts in this movie are wild, man. You're just like, wait, what?
We're gonna blow up Los Angeles. It's so
and like,
nonchalant.
Meanwhile, his kid and her friends are still just like riding around like nothing matters.
Yeah,
like they're just in a
Jeep
they're
in
with
the Jeep.
Top down.
Okay,
like,
so at this point,
wake me up.
The last
you go,
scene,
go.
The
yeah.
last
yeah.
scene with the daughter in it. She was they were talking in a car. From now on. Does she say anything?
Like two words. It's nothing.
She does say something in the house.
In the house? It's got to be like one line.
It's less than
she doesn't say. She has like three more lines in yeah. this movie, and that's it.
She is a daughter. That is what she does in this movie.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
The movie hates women. the characters aren't anything except...
I don't know if it hates as much as just disregards them as important.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay. It just disregards them as, yeah. like, yeah.
It's pretty incredible, actually. Yeah. yeah. It's kind of insane. Which
actually, I guess there were women there. I can't keep track of those.
Yeah.
So...
It's like asking how many dogs someone had. I don't remember.
How many marmots they had. It's like, whatever.
Could have been one, could have been 100. I have no idea.
Because it's her aunt and her in the house, and then her aunt is like packing up frantically because they got to leave. She's like,
right.
We got to get out of here immediately. But then Mark Costas calls. Yeah. This scene, it doesn't make any sense. He calls the sister, and he's like, I'm going to get you extracted.
I made arrangements.
You're going to get extracted by, there's cops are going to show up at the house. Go with them. And she's like, you're a piece of shit. You're not showing up. What am I going to tell your daughter? And she's just like, in the doorway. Like, she's like a foot from this. She's like crying. She's yelling at him about how he's never there for her. And he's like, tell her I'll see her as soon as I can. And she goes, tell her yourself. And then hangs up.
Yes.
She's right next to her. She's like, you never talk to her. Tell her yourself. Hang up. Yeah, let's get out of here. And then they run.
Do they run or do the cops come to
the cop? Well, they run away with the cops.
Storm the castle.
Yeah.
They literally
burst into the house and almost knocked his daughter over.
I thought they were terrorists. I was like, wait, what's happening now?
Yeah, I really thought that they were like kidnapping him and it was going to be like, because that would have been an exciting plot point.
That would have made sense for her to get kidnapped then.
Yeah.
But by who? But for what?
The evil general. Which we will get to.
By the mantle of the earth.
Was he? Was that? What was happening?
It looked like, yeah.
Start talking about that.
I know.
Okay.
Here we go.
To the cops.
Take them. They're in the car.
To give them special transport.
We're good.
Which is not a helicopter. It is a car.
It's a car.
In Los Angeles.
In the middle of all this.
After the president has just said it's going to be blown up by the government. Their plan here is to get them out with a car.
He calls them an extraction team.
It's two cops.
It's a car.
And then they're in the tunnel. They take a tunnel.
Which is like, come on.
The last place I want to be on Earth is in a fucking tunnel in Los Angeles after the president made that announcement. Like, ever.
Yeah,
hold on. Between that, though, the team gets assembled.
That's right. He brings the team in.
The special forces team,
He's like, at this point, you'd be like, we're going to have a quirky intro to all these people. Yeah.
Not really.
They all get out of a truck, and he goes, "Hey, Dave, Norris, sup?"
Like fingers
is the only one he talks to,
and he doesn't really do anything in the movie besides wait at a plane.
And he actually turns his back on them inadvertently because he's a fucking idiot, and it doesn't, like everything else in the movie, never gets addressed.
Right? It's whatever.
It's like everybody has autism or like something where they're just like, "No, I don't know. Well, I guess we just don't talk about it because it happened."
Yeah.
No. We gotta address this shit, motherfucker. What are you doing? Anyway, all right.
I thought the team was going to be like a big deal.
Yeah, they're nothing. Yeah.
Like they were going to be like the top of the top, creme de la creme.
They say less than anything.
And like, they do literally
less
nothing.
Than nothing.
And the only just... one we find we'll get to it. That's the best part.
Yeah, they do nothing.
Well, but like the one dude like who's like the Styles. Drill expert.
Oh, yeah.
Is like
Styles.
Styles.
No, Styles didn't do that. The drill expert was Norris and the black guy. I can't remember his name.
I don't even know that he got a name.
He might not have had one. I mean,
there might have even just been a head nod.
Black people are lower than women, so like, why would that character
didn't
even
have a name? He's the non-white man. He's
God. And like,
that's what the title is. Scorching, you know, racial stereotypes. It's terrible.
Yeah, and they're just like, hey, like, we get the gang back together, but
were they ever together?
Yeah,
do we know this?
Like, it showed that, like, all those cops driving over the bridge, and I thought it was going to be like Independence Day, Armageddon, where they like they had to chase down the one guy on the motorcycle.
But
it wasn't. It was like they all just got out of a van.
Although that
like,
shot
whatever.
Made me think the same. It was like that.
Yeah,
shot.
I thought it was going to be a guy
chasing Michael Clark Duncan.
Yeah.
And it wasn't that.
No, this movie fucking is nuts. It was somebody just watched a whole bunch of movies and like, these are some cool scenes.
Remember the president was like,
global warming's a thing.
When he saw DeCassis at the debriefing, he said the thing about like him being disgraced because he propositioned the president's wife.
Oh, yeah. He tried to fuck the president's
wife. A man
wife.
Who we saw tried to fuck a woman during a fucking volcano erupting. Apparently tried to fuck the president's wife as well.
He's a class act, this guy.
He's the hero of our story.
He's the hero
of our
story. We
care about him and his daughter's relationship.
Yeah, we care about this, like, flaccid penis of a daughter. Like,
dude, she's nothing, man.
She doesn't really talk at all.
She could have been a doll. It didn't matter.
just fucking real doll.
Yeah, just buy a real doll.
Okay.
Oh my god, that would have been amazing if they.
God damn
most
it!
Most of the movie just standing, staring at stuff.
Or running like weird, like she had her hands out, like flailing, but her hands were down.
So all right. So that's when they're in the tunnel, and the Mark DeCosta's sister's being all like, she smokes a cigarette, and the cops are like, you can't do that. And then she puts it out like on the door. It's like, dude, what the fuck? But then they're like...
Was that supposed to be funny because of what happens next?
I don't know.
Like, was that supposed to be the joke?
Maybe.
Like no smoking or fire or hot shit in the car.
Oh, God.
So then they're down in there, and there's another earthquake.
A bitch who we don't know anything about.
Yeah, she just immediately... Her character immediately gets bitchy.
She yells at Mark DeCosta's, and then she does that shit,
and then starts erupting around them.
Yeah. And then they get out of the car. There's like a fireball coming at them, and the aunt like pushes the daughter into the trunk and closes it, and then
it gets vaporized.
Yeah,
actually vaporized, because when you see the trunk open later, there's nothing
there. Yeah, like
no bones. What kind of fire was that?
Yeah, it's like Repo Man.
That must be the scene.
Just gone.
Yeah,
that must be the scene from Daylight that they took.
Yeah, it absolutely is.
That fire rolling through the tunnel.
Yeah, it has to.
They couldn't afford it, dude. Most of this movie took place in an underground tunnel.
Yeah.
It did.
And a big room that was so massive you never saw the walls because it was just in the middle of a fucking soundstage. This movie had no money.
Situation room or whatever that they had, like
it had
a pool table though. Did you notice that there was a pool table in there?
Was there?
Yeah.
Oh, stop.
It was a green felt table
that they just put maps over.
Yeah,
it was definitely a pool table.
That'd be great if it was
amazing.
Well,
or like a craps
planning
table.
War. You need to have
it might have been a craps table.
Recess every now and then. Yeah. You know, craps table in a war room.
They're just like betting on whether or not they're gonna win.
Where are we? It's the mom. The
tunnel happens. The aunt is vaporized.
And a car trunk saves her from a ball of fire that's compressed fire shooting through a tunnel. And I think that trunk wouldn't have saved her. She would suffocate in there, probably.
Probably.
The heat?
I feel like she would
suffocate. That'd be like an oven for a couple minutes. Think about it.
Maybe.
All right.
Anyway, then the... Mark DeCosta also confronts, what's his name, Holloway? Was that his name?
The evil guy?
Yeah.
Lieutenant Harris.
Not Lieutenant Harris.
The rapist from Shawshank.
Oh, the rapist from Shawshank. Right.
He's on the team, but Mark DeCosta doesn't want him to be. And they keep butting heads. He's on the team. They land the planes. The general's Lieutenant Harris.
You guys
like,
probably don't remember Armageddon that much, but he's basically playing William Fichtner's role in
Armageddon.
Except
he doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't make sense, but they added that character in there. Yes. That one who's like on the mission to
Really. He's also
like
Michael Bane in
the face of all things to get things done.
Yeah, he's like Michael Bane in The Abyss.
Yes, like that.
Yes.
He's that character, but it doesn't make any sense.
But it doesn't work.
It doesn't make any
all
sense.
All it does is add 10 minutes to the movie.
But the director's cut of The Abyss is really good.
Oh, I love every cut of The Abyss.
They really wanted to make a Bruckheimer movie, like a big budget Bruckheimer movie.
Yeah, but
and
they
it just
didn't have the budget for
or the fucking patience to make understand what makes those really simple scripts work at all. Okay, so yeah,
they land.
What's
in
that guy's
LA.
Name again?
All right,
the rapist from Shawshank. What's his name in this movie?
Oh, it's like Holloway, I think.
Holloway. Okay,
I think it is.
Right.
Anyway. It is now.
He's working closely with
the general.
Yeah,
Captain Harris.
But they fly a plane to an airport outside of L.A., then get inside of army trucks with police escorts to drive to the space.
To
drill a hole
the
that's going to take 6 to 7 hours to do.
This is
so that they can plant a bomb and escape.
As we have said, this is not Escape from L.A.
And yeah.
It's not a quarantine zone.
Yes. No. I don't think we brought that up yet, actually, on the show now, right?
No.
The fact that as soon as L.A. was evacuated, they treat it like there's no power. Like, it's nothing. Oh, yeah, it's
closed down.
It's just shut completely down. And then there's like, wait, have we gotten to... Oh, no, we're getting to that now.
But I think gotta be this confusing.
This is a point that does not matter, but there's got to be nuclear power plants near L.A. There has to be, right?
Dude, just because it's unattended doesn't mean it wouldn't be running. They're about to blow the city up.
No, I'm what I'm saying
nobody's going to properly shut anything down when the president's on the TV going, we're blowing up L.A. in 12 hours.
I don't give a fuck. Just leave.
Like, everything would still be on.
Right, what I'm saying is
TV shows, like live TV shows with cameras still running places. You know what I mean? Like there was power, phones worked.
They act like it is fucking 28 days later.
Yeah.
You know, just like
within the span of a day.
It's been hours. It's been like 5 hours. And they're expecting zombies to pop out.
No, and seriously, that's Escape from LA. They think it's Escape from LA. Like they're going into some quarantine zone. But
the first thing they run into is a blockade put up by someone.
By a crazy person that
they
never...
Who starts shooting at them and kills... All right.
Okay, before they get there, they're in the cars. And which guy was it?
His name was Anderson. I only know that because he says... The two people who die, they get their names said. And that's why I know their names.
Yep.
Anderson tells us the story of the fact that he is a family man.
Yes.
That he has 7 kids with one on the way.
One on the way.
Never mentioned his wife, though.
Never mentioned his wife.
Why would he, Matt?
Just pointing out how everyone's wife is completely irrelevant.
Yep. Yeah, totally, 100%. Yeah. And
he has pictures of all 7 kids, too.
And none of his wife. None of his wife. It's all individual pictures of the children.
Here's this one's just a drawing of what I think the next one's going to look like. Like, there's an extra space, but he still didn't use it for his wife. Like, what the fuck is your problem, dude?
They pull up to, like, station wagons that have clothes all hung all over them.
Yes.
It's weird.
They're blocking the street.
But it just looked, like, weird.
Let's not forget.
The trunks were open.
Hold up.
This is, like, 3-4 hours in. This is only...
The city is freshly evacuated. Yeah.
Can we please not forget, though? Can we please not forget that after everybody's talking about having a family and all that stuff, what's his name? Fingers is like, he's like, oh, that sounds like death to me or something. Like, he's just like, that's terrible. I'm never going to live like that.
Hey, he's a Rolling Stone, Kathy.
That's right.
No moss for him, okay?
It's just like, it's like, was that even necessary?
Yeah, no one thought you were going to have a kid, Fingers.
No one wants you to have a kid.
Yeah, we don't want that. No. Gene pool. So
you're too wacky.
Too wacky.
He's too crazy.
He did that weird, like, finger dance.
Oh, yeah,
that
yeah, yeah.
Finger earlier. Dance.
That's why they call them fingers. Yeah. He got a little finger dance. So then they're getting...
They get attacked. Anderson gets killed immediately.
He gets shot. Camera, like, wide shot on him. He gets shot through the chest twice.
Yeah.
Brutal. Like,
just to show you there's no hope.
Execution.
Yeah, just to show you there's no hope of him being resurrected. Like, it's like, nope, straight through. He wasn't wearing a vest.
Dude, these were the worst special agents I've ever seen.
Yeah.
In any movie.
I don't know why you would choose them to be your... Well, my theory was that, like, they chose them as the team, so it wouldn't matter if they didn't get out. Like, from the mission. They're all just a bunch
of
dirtbags.
See, I thought it was going to go there, and it never did.
No.
It never became like the president said they were expendable.
Yeah, which I thought like would be like a
thing. If only this came out after the Expendables, then they would have had that idea.
Probably.
And then used footage from it.
It would have made sense. That movie could have used actually another 10 minutes. The way it ended, you could have tacked on another 10 minutes.
Yeah, there you go. It's fine.
Jason Statham shows up and kicks somebody out of a window. God. Jason Statham shows up and kicks W.G. Bailey out of a fucking window.
It'd be great. And he falls all the way down a building like Ronnie Cox and RoboCop. It's like, oh, yeah.
Love it.
So they get attacked with machine guns by some gang.
I guess it's a gang.
It's just one guy on a roof. And then they go, who were they? And I was like, that was one guy.
It was just one guy that I just saw.
they weren't anything. It was just people shooting at them.
And they were like, I guess they're rioters.
They had a giant armored truck. Why didn't they just push past those cars and just keep moving?
It wasn't an armored truck, even. It was just a covered, like, army
They're
transport.
So ill-prepared for action.
Fly a helicopter directly where you need to go! Why?
Fingers literally had access to a helicopter.
Yeah, I guess because of the drill, but there's... That drill looked like shit, man.
Yeah, we're not so there. We're not there.
Why are they driving? It's just so weird. So and how many of these blockades are set up by random gangs of people who hang out on roofs and just start shooting
within
people?
Within 3 hours.
Within
too.
Hours of it.
Yeah.
You're just like, what happened?
And there's so little, like, interaction with the government. We're talking, like, 10 people involved
here. Yeah.
This is, like, the biggest thing that ever happened in human history.
And there's no protests? There's no, like, or any,
I like
outrage?
I was actually going to say I kind of enjoy how they don't show, like, reactions from around the world about being like, oh, God. Don't
like
matter. The rest of the world doesn't matter.
Yeah.
America's great, and women are here, apparently.
Allegedly.
Allegedly, there are women
wonderful
here.
Breeding machines.
Yeah.
That's it.
Oh, my God. What a weird universe. Man, it's awesome.
Okay, so we're at this point, the daughter gets out of the trunk. Mm-hmm. She's alive. She survived.
Yes.
So now she's wandering the streets of fucking L.A., post-apocalyptic L.A.,
before
even
that,
though it's not.
Before that earlier, just got to mention, Lieutenant Harris got message that the tunnel fire happened and that police car was,
oh, that's right.
Everybody was
oh,
dead.
Oh, right, yeah.
Was possibly dead.
Right.
And then Mark Dacascos was like, what's up with my daughter? And he's like, oh, she's on a helicopter right now. And he lied to him.
Well, he wants the mission to keep going.
Yeah, right. But it's important for the plot, sort of.
No, there is a progression there.
Yeah,
of.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, they're like, oh, yeah, we have to address
keep lying
that.
About that.
But this will be... This would bring us to the movie within a movie.
Yeah, I feel like you guys got way excited because it was going to be something crazier, but it's pretty weird.
I mean, it's pretty nuts considering the blandness of the movie it's in.
Yeah.
The movie's pretty bland, and then that happens.
Yeah.
So she's, like, wandering the streets. She hears a police siren. She starts running towards it, screaming, I'm here, I'm here. Gets clotheslined in the throat by someone.
Yes, because women don't matter.
No. Take them down. Took her to the ground, drug her through something. The cops pull by and just miss her with the flashlight.
Yep.
And then she wakes up in a room, tied.
She's like handcuffed to the ceiling.
To a pipe.
In like the back room of an electronics store.
Yes. There's like boxes of shit everywhere. And you can hear a preacher talking about the end of days on a TV really loud. And then there's this guy, man. He just shows up.
He looks like Dark Man.
He does.
Of.
I mean,
like poor
he looks
man,
like,
Dark Man.
He looks like powder with like burn scars.
Yeah. Well, it's like.
Did you ever see Judge Dredd, the Stallone one?
Yeah.
Like, you know, like, I'm going to stick him, Paul.
Oh, yeah.
Like that
yeah.
guy's face.
Yeah, yeah.
Like half Frankenstein sewn up face.
It's just real gross looking.
How about Jigsaw from Punisher Warzone? Is that a good.
Close.
Sort of like
they
that?
They just didn't. They didn't give you enough. There was never a really good shot of it because I think it probably looked like hell.
It looked bad, but there's no reason. We don't ever find out why this guy's all fucking scarred up.
No. But they look like burn scars because they're like long.
Oh, yeah,
like,
they're definitely burn scars. Yeah.
To me, it looked like there was some stitching, too, though.
Well, they might have done reconstruction on his face or something.
In the last
skin
4 hours?
Skin grafts? Maybe he gives himself skin grafts.
Right. We have no backstory on this.
No, there's now his daughter's been kidnapped by albino Frankenstein.
Well, he's been kidnapped by the Scorcher.
Literally.
Okay, he's got a Zippo lighter and he's flicking it on and off. And then he starts pouring gasoline everywhere and she starts crying. And you're like, that's the Scorcher,
right?
Yeah, he's
what's the Scorcher. Is everything been leading up to this? Is this going to like take over the movie?
No.
Does he have superpowers where he can control the Earth's tectonic plates
or
something? No.
Did he set all this in motion because he decided it wasn't hot enough?
No.
It's fucking, like, amazing.
But what does he do? He says, like, he points to his other victims that are in the room.
Yeah.
It's like a head.
It's a bathtub or something?
No, it's like a shelf. It's the, like, storage shelf.
Oh,
it's
got,
like, a head on it.
People that been burned to a crisp.
And an arm.
There's a head and an arm.
So you have a serial killer that burns people up.
And he
in a movie
himself,
called Scorcher.
He himself is covered in burn scars. He's dressed like Dark Man. He's listening to like preacher shit and going like, brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
In a movie called Scorcher, and he is not.
And he has nothing to do with it.
He's just there.
He's just kind of there.
It's kind of beautiful.
I know, man. I was laughing so hard at the next scene with him, like when it ends. I was like, are you serious?
Because
you
could replace all this stuff with her just being incapacitated for a long time.
Stuck in that trunk. Being like the fire in the tunnels getting worse. You know what I mean?
Then she realizes
like,
there's a BlackBerry in another car or something. You know,
anything.
It didn't need to be this.
It didn't. It's bonkers.
And
man. You
kind of wonder, what is the title referring to?
At all.
I don't know.
That's what I said to you. It's mostly earthquakes.
Right.
Most of the problems are earthquakes and people are sort of
tectonic
sweaty.
Plates. I mean, that's the point of the...
Yeah.
Well, but they don't even really have that many outstanding issues
with the earthquakes.
With the surrounding area. There's nothing really happening around them.
Yeah,
it's not like the Earth is getting hotter by the second already, and there's like a tipping point we're gonna hit that we can't get back from.
Right.
It's like everything's normal. There's just a bunch of earthquakes.
Which doesn't LA already has earthquakes?
Yeah. Dude, it's crazy.
Whatever. It doesn't
matter. Okay.
It doesn't matter. So, know that the daughter is being held by a serial killer that's probably named Scorcher.
I can't believe.
It's kind of amazing.
Completely wasted. I want to remake it. Like, do the Scorcher where it's about him, but the nuclear bomb thing is, like, barely mentioned. It's only in, like, three scenes.
Like, the world's crumbling and you just see his story.
Yeah. Be awesome.
Okay. What happens after that? Fuck. Then they're just in the tunnel for forever.
Now
drilling, right?
After they got attacked, the big trucks don't work anymore.
Yep.
So now they're on these, like, and their communications got destroyed.
That's right.
Now they're driving.
Yeah. It got destroyed in the gunfire.
Yeah. Now they're driving around on these scooter buggies, like military scooter buggies with the bombs on them. Because there's two bombs. We forgot about that.
Oh, yeah.
And Mark DeCasas was like,
he tells that stupid story.
Which is only stupid because it never gets meant. It doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, it sounds like it's supposed to mean. Okay, so he tells this story, and it sounds like it's supposed to mean something. And he's like, back in 4th of July, 1972.
Oh, shit. We're at an hour already. All right. Let's
finish it up.
Finish it up, Kathy. Keep going.
So, like, he tells this stupid story about, like,
a dud firecracker
that he lit. And, like, it was the first time he got to light a firecracker. And he's like, that's what I want, too. I don't like duds, you know?
I don't like duds.
But that's supposed to pay off somewhere else, but it never does.
No.
There was never a dud.
The two bombs pay off, but his anecdote is useless.
Yeah.
Was his anecdote just so they used two?
Well, so they were only supposed to use...
But they needed two because they needed the spacing of it.
Yeah, no, so...
Well, yeah, for later,
but it has nothing to do with, like, a safe, fail-safe
dud
thing.
Well, they haven't figured that out. No, they haven't figured that out
yet. How would you know it was a dud if you have to do it at a specific time and it didn't happen? You don't have a second chance to do it again, right?
I guess.
Was he just going to stuff both of them down the hole?
I guess. But, like, so they haven't figured out that they need two yet.
No.
But then the lady scientist is doing, like, calculations.
Well, hold on. We haven't, like, gotten to the place yet. Because when they lose the communications, the president's like, the nukes are AWOL. I want proof that our boys still have them.
And you're like, right.
But they're still heading towards the place only you guys know you're supposed to head to put these bombs.
Why don't you just go there?
We get to that where this is another amazing part of the movie where they flew a plane to outside the city, got in trucks, drove in trucks, got attacked. People died. They've been driving in these tiny little things. It's a fucking hassle now. They're riding through like sewer tunnels and shit. The president goes, I want visual confirmation. Two helicopters.
Yeah. Again.
With like four people in them each are there within minutes.
And the
visually confirmed.
And they don't even find them. They go, there's like some ATV tracks coming out of the waterway here into a service tunnel.
It's amazing.
And the president's like, oh, well, it's good. It's them.
Yeah.
Get the fuck out of a helicopter and help them. Send a helicopter in the first place.
And like
what are you doing? They got there so fast. anyone else doing? It's just like,
dude, it was
where is everyone?
It was a 3-minute thing to get from where they are to them. They spent the whole movie traversing this fucking terrain.
And the weapons aren't that big. They're just these kind of like...
a human being in this movie lifts them up with a duffel bag.
With a duffel bag.
It's not that... Look, it's amazing.
Yeah. You could have just loaded those into a fucking helicopter, flown it directly to this thing, and then had a party.
You know what I mean? You could have... packed a scooter.
The timer meant nothing.
You could have packed a scooter there. And the weapon and had the scooter to take it into the tunnel to like take it even further into the tunnel if you should happen to do that on the helicopter. they could have packed everything.
Like airlift a fucking car to drive under the tunnel.
They do that with
yeah, you're right.
And shit all the time. Like you just lift those.
Operation
like...
Dumbo Drop. Come on, man.
Jesus. It's just maddening because the whole reason that they eventually need the second bomb is that other earthquake happens. And it's like, well, if you got there quicker and blew the
first one
up
before this,
you wouldn't have to do it again. It's fucking crazy. It's, all right. What the fuck?
And you know what? The whole visual confirmation thing could be easily edited out and has no effect on the plot.
Nope.
So they went out of their way to show us that they could have done everything more efficiently with a scene that was not needed.
Yep.
Yeah.
They also could have, you know, been like, oh, well, we know where they are. We should give them a new communication device so we can speak to them. So, you know, people don't just start murdering each other under assumptions at some point. You know what I mean? Like, fuck all of you.
It really goes off the rails. It really goes.
Once they go into that tunnel,
it's
bonkers.
It's game over.
They pull out this weird-ass NASA drill that looks like dog shit.
It looks like they made it at Home Depot.
It's wobbling. They're like holding it up here. Like,
with their hands. Like, you shouldn't have to hold that with your hand.
It doesn't make any sense.
And why you would have to be some kind of expert to use it is beyond me, because it looks
like it just like it goes straight down.
Yeah,
and
you just push a button.
But this is where Holloway starts
getting real creepy.
Real creepy. Yeah. He starts like arguing with people.
Because
Mark
the general
continues to. Oh, Styles hits on Fate at this point.
Styles,
which is like,
who I'm pretty sure is a continuation of Teen Wolf.
Yeah. What was his joke that he starts that scene with? It was horrific.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, shit.
Pork. It was like a sex joke.
It was a terrible sex joke.
It had like a sex punchline.
I missed it. I missed it.
Christ
when
he said
in it.
It was really bad.
Again, women don't matter.
This is more important.
Thank you for all of that.
Huey's here to interrupt the show, as always.
Hi.
Where are we? Holloway is evil.
They're in the tunnel. Yeah, they're starting the drill. Then Styles is hitting on Faith. Then Faith is like, get away from me. You're fucking creepy. And she starts hanging out with Mark Dacascos, and they're getting buddy-buddy. And then... an earthquake, right before the earthquake happens. No, yeah, an earthquake happens. Styles runs down a hallway for no reason and then gets killed by a falling piece of the ceiling.
Yeah.
Right. Had he just stayed where he was, he would still be alive.
He got what he deserved, you know,
I guess.
For hitting on women.
Sure.
For giving them attention.
Exactly.
That's how dare you.
He dies, and then they get back to drilling, and fucking the Faith recalculates everything. She's like, that second earthquake sped up the plate.
So we need to go. We had to do two.
That's
we need to,
right.
We but need her to dad disagrees.
Yes, he doesn't
think that. And he's like, you're my daughter and a woman, and you're not me. So shut up.
And then the general
tells... Stop being irrational. He said that, didn't he?
Yes.
Stop being irrational.
Stop being irrational.
She's
like,
scientist.
Look at the numbers. You're being insane, woman. It's like, what?
Yeah, she's like.
Why are you fighting this so fucking hard?
She's like, you can run all the peripherals you want on it, but the data's real. And it's like,
no. The amount of times she said, look at the numbers in this movie to various different people.
I just like, you're being irrational to a scientist.
Yeah, showing you
data. You're being irrational.
Also,
I got four fucking pie graphs, motherfucker. I'm not being irrational.
The general calls Holloway. At this point, it tells him to keep one of the nukes.
Well, no,
it doesn't make a lot of sense.
Here, this is what happens. Okay.
He wants to go with the original plan, right?
She recalculates. They get into an argument. DeMarc Dacascos overhears it, walks over, and he goes, what's going on? And she's like, I think we need to blow up another bomb at least 10 miles from here. I love that it doesn't matter because they had to blow up L.A. But where the second bomb is kind of
anywhere,
irrelevant.
It's fine.
It's awesome. It's like, what? Okay. And then he's like, well, that sounds interesting. What? How do we do that? And then Johnny Davis is like, I'm in charge here. And I said no. And then Holloway's like, what's going on here? Blah, blah, blah. That's when the general calls.
Right.
Talks to fucking Mark Dacascos. He explains what's going on, and he goes, you do whatever the doctor says. His word is gospel.
You're right.
He says that. He goes, his word is gospel. Then, so he's like, well, all right, so we're not blowing up that second bomb. But while he was talking to the general, his daughter, there's a cut scene to his daughter. But during the second earthquake, his daughter, the pipe she was affixed to, broke, and she scrambled to the room that had a BlackBerry in a box, a sealed BlackBerry,
right.
A sealed unactivated BlackBerry in 2002, where there is no Wi-Fi.
While the guy who's holding her captive is in the other room, like with a strobe light on or whatever.
Yeah, he's got like a party light. It's like a yellow, red, blue. Like,
and he's just having
light.
Like, you know, religious orgasms about the coming end of the
oh!
world.
Oh, like he falls to his knees and just starts screaming at one point. That guy did an awesome job of being like a complete creepy weird.
Yeah, he earned
thing.
His days.
And she's moving. She's like flailing around basically.
She makes
like
a lot of noise.
And like he never turns around once. No. While she's doing anything.
Kathy, he's in like a trance state.
Sure.
But he does eventually hear her because she calls in the other room. He finds her and she starts screaming and he chains her to a different thing. Like one of the racks closer to the phone. She gets the phone. So when Mark Dacascos is talking to the general, he gets a text on his BlackBerry from his daughter somehow that says, I'm alive. I'm in L.A. Help.
Yeah.
And he's just like, so where's my daughter? And he's like, she's in D.C. by now, I imagine.
Yeah.
And he's just like, cool. Hangs up and he's just like pissed. And that's when he decides he's going to go find his daughter. Holloway's, you're not going anywhere, pulls a gun on him.
Yeah, Holloway
like,
resorts
so this is where Holloway
to
gets
like homicidal violence for no reason.
Yeah.
Like, I never understood, is Holloway trying to accomplish the goal of stopping the threat.
But he wanted to be the hero that made sure it happened.
Did he? It just didn't feel like that.
Didn't eventually. At first, I was.
He just
looked
like a murdering asshole.
Well, because he says that Science Lady asked him to be on the team in case Mark Dacascos screwed it up, and they have a little lover spat.
Yeah.
But like.
But he believes in the one nuke plan.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But
he wants to be the guy
but he is with her.
Yeah,
more.
But like
he wants to be the underdog that comes out on top and gets famous for the saving the world.
But then
they never established that.
But I would assume
all.
That's what his motivation is.
Well, yeah, because at one
I
point
have
they,
to. I mean, I don't know what else the fuck else.
Do
you
talk
going
about
on.
The good guy bad guy thing?
Yeah. They do that. Oh god.
That was a little bit on the nose.
Yeah. The Holloway shit is so convoluted it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, like I said, it just adds a couple minutes to the movie.
Oh yeah, because he wanted him to disarm the bomb.
The funny thing is, you know what Holloway does? It, you know, just from a production perspective, he kills everyone in a cheap way, which is by shooting them.
Yeah, without an explosion.
You don't need to have an explosion or rocks falling or lava. You just have
a
guy go insane.
Movie.
Just pump full lead. Just let's get it over with.
Okay,
so, well, he pulls a gun on him, but then Norris, the like guy who prayed earlier, which was weird.
Oh, right. We skipped
the
fact that there's a full-blown religious Christian prayer.
It was very strange.
Yeah.
But he gets an upper hand on Holloway, and they like tie him up and set the bomb and are continuing to drill. And he's like, I'm going to go find my daughter and find you guys, meet you at the extraction point. But then the daughter like cuts him off with the nuke in a duffel bag.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is hilarious. And then she's like, no, we got to set off the second nuke. Otherwise everybody's going to die. And he's like, all right, fine. But I'm getting my daughter first. And they drive away. And he's like, he's driving. And he pulls out the BlackBerry. And he goes, where are you? To his daughter. And while he's waiting, he goes, I don't have time for this. And then drives
it's
off.
Amazing.
And you're like, but you don't know where you're going
at
all.
No,
she's could be anywhere in L.A. And you're just going to start driving.
Yeah.
It's nuts.
You
it's
just gotta
big,
go,
man.
You just gotta go.
It's just a city in America.
Yeah, and she's just lost in a hellscape, fucking rioting and shit.
She was only knocked unconscious and drugged inside a building. Like, come on. It's gonna be so easy to find her. But it is, because she sees like a box that has the address on it. So that's when the true Scorcher storyline comes
Jesus
to an end, which
Christ.
Is like,
in the worst possible
it's
way.
It's so anticlimactic. So it's nothing. It
like,
means
he just suddenly
nothing.
Pops in.
He there
just,
wasn't even tension. He yeah, just he walks in the door.
He poured gasoline on her hours ago at this point.
Yeah.
They were drilling that hole for like 6 or 7 hours.
And then he went in the other room and masturbated to the news.
For like
yeah.
7 hours.
Yeah.
And then he comes out with a new torch and he's like about to burn her, and they come in and Mark DeCostas shoots him in the chest like 8 times. He has a whole
over.
Clip into him.
Mini movie over.
It was
the
yeah.
Scorcher, the horror movie.
You
could
see the sheet of squibs underneath his shirt. You know, like it was just
it's just
awful.
So disappointing.
Yeah,
it's
like,
so
oh,
disappointing.
Okay.
Like, fuck Halloway. Have him have to fight, be the reason the last bomb is like a pain
yeah.
in the ass.
Or
you know
have
I mean?
Him be like, yeah, have him be like a wizard causing everything.
Oh, and
you know what I mean?
If he was like a demon and he
yeah.
was like, or
yeah.
there was like Morlocks
was
under
like
the
a,
earth.
Yeah, the Scorcher, he's from hell.
Oh, that
oh,
would
or
that
some shit.
Awesome.
I mean, who cares if it's dumb? At least it would have been interesting.
You don't just shoot him in the
chest and he's it's done.
And
it's
he
nuts,
shoots, Halloway shoots the doctor. Did we say
well,
that?
Well, while they're out, the two guys set the bomb.
Yeah.
The two good
and
guys
like, are
left
you done?
Set the bomb.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, and then he's done there, his handcuffs or whatever, and he kills them.
Oh, right.
And then
right.
he's like loading up the little truck thing to go chase down Mark DeCostas, and John Rhys-Davies has figured out that his daughter's right, and he goes back and he's like, ah, my daughter was right. We got to blow up the second nuke. Now, that guy's orders were
his word is
gospel.
Well, yeah.
And you have to get that nuke back. Which one matters?
Why does it matter to get that nuke back? You just set off the one that's already in the ground.
I know.
Yeah,
I don't understand why
it doesn't make
he...
any sense. Like, if he said we're fucked up and we got to do it this way, he should have been
like, okay, I want to see this through. Because then
the
new mission.
He had that line earlier where he's like, we all have our... Oh, no, he says it right there. Because he stabs John Rhys-Davies. And he's like,
yeah.
We all have our
You know what
orders.
They could have done? They could have given a reason for people going insane somehow. Like, gases were coming up from the earth that would make you insane.
Something.
And that
something
would explain the
like...
Scorcher serial killer. And then maybe we could have shown Halloway get, like, a puff of it, hit him in the face, and him a pipe or some shit, and he goes nuts. At least that would have explained why this doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, yeah.
Unless he kind of went... went Michael Biehn in The Abyss, and he just kind of goes off the rocker... But he didn't have enough time to
pressure,
do that.
Like, it's just pressure based.
Or the isolation of being. It's like.
But it just doesn't.
Being underwater like that's like being in space.
It just
space.
Doesn't
You're
seem
just
like there's enough time or pressure. And that's not established that he has any
no.
of these tics.
Yeah, man. It just comes. It comes out of nowhere and then he kills everybody.
Whatever.
He cleans up
We're
the
at
story.
The end. We're at the end. It's fine. It
so,
doesn't matter. We're
Martin
finally Costas here.
Has his daughter. They're like, we got to blow up this bomb, but we don't know how to dig a hole. And he's like, I'm just figuring we can drop it in a gorge or something. And his daughter's like, I know of a deep hole.
Yeah, she does.
And where is it? What's the hole?
The hole from the beginning of the movie.
Oh, shit.
Oh, my gosh.
So they go to the subway.
I almost forgot.
They get on the subway train. Mark DeCostas starts driving a subway car. Fucking Halloway, like, chases it down.
Spider-Man's on it.
Just jumps on the back of it, piggybacks his way with them. They get off. They head down to the fucking thing. They set up the nuke. They're about to drop he sets it the arm. They're about to throw it down the thing. And Halloway shows up, grabs his daughter, who still hasn't said a fucking word.
No, she's still not. She's nothing.
Yeah.
She's a rice cake of
she's
a human
just
being.
She's there except to say that I needed a hole. I mean, I found a hole. I have a hole.
Also,
I am a hole. I'm a woman in
oh
this
gosh,
universe.
Oh, gosh. Yeah, right? I am a hole. I am a hole. What else was
movie,
I going to say about her? There was something else about her.
Her face doesn't move. She runs dumb.
I mean, not in this scene, she doesn't really do anything
yeah,
except.
She shows them the way. And
she shows them to Zion.
And Holloway takes her and puts a gun to her neck.
Yeah, that's right.
Then he shoots Mark DeCostas.
They're setting up the nuclear bomb, which looks like a prop from a stage play. It just doesn't look good.
Yeah, it doesn't look like anything.
It looks like it's made out of a couple like potted plant, like plastic plant pots.
And painted. And like painted with house paint.
Yeah, and just put a fucking touchpad in the middle.
Right. And then, so Holloway sees them, comes in, puts a gun to her head.
He's like, disarm the bomb. And that's, and he's like, no. He's like, but I'll kill your daughter. And he's like, well, if the bomb doesn't go off, she'll die anyway.
I need the code to stop it.
You need the code to stop it. I have it. And that's when he pulls out his cell phone. And he goes, I'll just call the general. And they're like, you're 30 feet below the ground, idiot. Like, you can't do that. And it doesn't work. So then he just shoots Mark DeCostas in the arm.
And then they all like get huddled around him.
Did phones not have text messaging then?
I don't think he had some a
cell
of them
phone.
Did.
So he did have a cell phone. I don't know.
Did text work then?
I don't. Well, no, they definitely did.
So separate devices then. Like there was a text device and there was a cell phone.
I feel like they did.
I don't know.
Because for him to have a normal cell phone and then for her to have an e-messaging wireless device, just seems like, wait, this technology all seems like it would go together.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know, man.
It doesn't matter.
I would just like, I would just like to reiterate for everyone. Let's be clear that Mark DeCostas basically said, "I'm willing to take the risk of my daughter being shot to death by an evil person,
so I can
like save the world." Because if
there's a lot of men in the world,
I know.
I mean, die. So many men.
I'll give you that. But
he's saving so many men's lives, Kathy.
It still is.
It is important work.
It's like a lot of life. It's like the whole like North American continent versus his daughter.
I mean, I know, but it's just like, let's just be clear that he says that out loud.
You didn't need to have him say it.
The daughter heard him say that, and she will live with that for the rest of her life because she's still alive.
You didn't need to write that in there. Yeah. It could have just been, he could have just said,
I'll never stop you. I'll never let you win or something.
I'll never let you win. You don't have to answer it. Yeah. Like, oh, yeah, fuck her.
Yeah, fuck her.
You don't have to say it like that.
Think about everybody else for once, huh?
Yeah.
Fucking.
So he's got his gun in his face, and he's got him on the ground after he shot him. And then Faith hits him with a pipe in the head. He drops his gun. Then they have a fist fight.
Which kind of sucks for a Mark DeCostas movie. The fist fight sucks.
Yeah, it was not good. He's much better than that.
Yeah.
Yeah, he did great work in Drive.
Drive.
He was sick in Drive, dude. He was really good.
The action in Drive is amazing. Yeah. We did it on this show. Look it up. It's great.
But they fight, and then he's getting his ass kicked by Holloway. And Holloway picks up the nuke over his head.
Like he's gonna smash
him. He's gonna smash Mark DeCostas to death.
Might be the dumbest plan ever.
With a nuclear bomb.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
This is a man who's trying to kill a man that's trying to set off the nuclear bomb, and so his plan is to pick the bomb up and use it to smash him to death, possibly
bash it against stuff while it's armed.
Yeah, while it's armed.
While it's still armed.
He could use it as a weapon. Trying to kill him in the pursuit of
or
not
make it so
off.
You can't turn it off, which is what you're trying to do.
Oh God!
So instead of hitting him. Does, like, Mark DeCostas punch him
he
or something?
He just kicks him or
kicks him.
Something. It, what the fuck shots are really
and he
bad.
Falls through the hole. He falls through the break in the
super
cover.
Extended scene of Holloway falling down this hole.
Yes.
Hitting it really hard at the bottom, which at that point I thought he was just soup.
Yeah.
But no.
He lived.
He lived through that.
We forgot to talk about the isn't this funny? Isn't it usually the good guy who tries to stop the bad guy from blowing stuff up? And you guys were both just like,
I was like, don't call attention to the one unique thing you did.
Yeah.
By doing that, you make it not unique. whatever.
Hey, look, we did something smart. Oh, fuck.
Right? Say it. Know it. Acknowledge us.
Man.
Okay. Holloway's at the bottom with a nuclear weapon at the bottom of this hole, alive. Right? And they're running out because they
get out, and who should be there to pick them up but Fingers in a helicopter?
And this is a green screened shot of Fingers.
Oh, yeah, it's the airplane. Oh, yeah.
That shot
awful.
Was just.
Man. It was very
really
obvious
bad,
he was not in front of that.
He wasn't in front of that jet, and neither of those things were on that street. Man, it was bad looking.
It looked bad.
But then he says the line where he goes, "Hey, man, they tricked me into coming here to pick up that Holloway guy." And you're like, are you lying so they don't hate you because you clearly did fuck nothing this entire time?
He was dancing, remember? There's a shot of him dancing.
Show him dancing. Dude, he also has no idea everybody else is dead.
He doesn't care
either.
They
don't talk about it.
He doesn't ask where everyone is.
Actually, no, he doesn't ask where anybody else is.
So Fingers is actually like a mole, probably.
Possibly.
And he's like a double agent. So he doesn't care.
Well, either way, he gets him out of there with a plane. Not a helicopter, too. I feel like he's flying
a
plane.
Jet.
Yeah, it was that like private presidential jet.
And it wasn't have flown to the place in the first place.
It wasn't even like a True Lies jet where you can just land straight down.
No, it wasn't a Harrier
jet.
It
was like
a private
strip.
Oh, yeah. At one point, he was like, I'll be able to see the landing strip. And it's like, because it's dark, right? Like,
I didn't understand that line at all.
Yeah,
there were multiple lines.
It probably was like a landing strip pussy joke or something.
Well, yeah, okay.
There were
multiple
lines in this movie
that
didn't make sense, and a couple lines that the movie even pointed out that the lines didn't make sense. Where somebody would be like, "What did he even mean by that?"
Right.
Like that one comment where the woman says, "Daddy's little girl," about Mark Dacascos's daughter, and he's like, "She was that and more." Or something.
Oh yeah, that's wrong.
She was that and more.
Anyway,
but the end of the movie is right here.
Both the bombs go off.
Both the bombs go off. The plates stop moving. Everybody's happy. Everybody's happy, including the general who lied about his daughter, wanted that guy to kill people to get anything done.
Didn't trust anyone.
Lieutenant Harris.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then didn't want people to detonate the second nuke. Yeah.
He's the bad guy in the movie. He's technically the bad guy.
He's happy.
He's happy.
Mark Dacascos
no
gets on a plane.
Not a single ounce of comeuppance for him.
They get on the plane with Fingers, hug, movie ends, credits. It's insane. There's so many things that didn't get wrapped up.
The Holloway storyline deserves somebody getting punished.
Yeah.
It's not just
a
him.
A lot of people probably.
Yeah.
Like,
the president was deceived.
Yes.
And he doesn't get like his, you know, revenge on who deceived his plan.
And Mark Dacascos, do you think, I mean, he was trying to retire. You think he just went like, you know what?
Yeah, right.
I can say a lot of things, but you should just pay me real well because I'm retiring.
I need a beach.
I need to buy kites.
Yeah.
You guys.
I want my daughter to be mute and sit next to me on a beach.
Yeah.
While I fly kites.
And she'll just be surrounded by kites like a fence, and she will be so scared and useless that she will not be able to escape that fence of kites. You know?
Well, I'm having sex with one of those.
One of those.
He just points to the Teresa.
Just any woman in the room. One of those.
One of those. I'm having sex with one of those holes over there.
So that's,
Scorcher.
Yeah,
Scorcher,
man.
Scorcher.
What a movie.
I would love to know how the serial killer thing came about. It just feels so out of place.
Yeah.
She could have been
stuck in that trunk that whole time. It would have been fine.
It's like they had serial killer footage with her, and then they just shot the scenes with the characters in this movie with her in the same clothes. It just seems like it just came out of so...
Mm-hmm. Like they had like a half-finished movie or
something. Yeah, yeah. And they're just like, we need like 20 more minutes, so let's get a fucking creepoid to drag her into his lair that is an electronics store.
And dump gas on her, but then not burn her for a couple hours. Like, what?
There's not a single human on fire in this whole movie.
No.
No.
I mean, there's people that get vaporized.
Get vaporized,
but that's like an effect.
But you never even see it. You don't even see it.
Yeah, you don't even see it.
Get vaporized.
There wasn't even the classic, like, dude in a bunch of goo getting lit on fire action movie thing.
Nope.
It's a pretty sad movie. This is a sad movie.
I didn't realize how low budget it was until this second viewing. And now I know.
How'd you not realize that first shot?
Because, like I said, I watch these while I'm doing other stuff sometimes. Oh. So, like... It didn't dawn on me that so much of the movie was just them in that tunnel or that room that didn't have walls. I was like, Christ,
there's
like no locations in this movie.
One thing we didn't talk about, I just want to mention, is that at one point, Mark Dacascos and Teresa are having this like back and forth about like their family. And she's talking about her father in a way that like John Rhys-Davies has been dead for years.
Oh yeah, but he's still alive.
And there's a shot of her looking at the stars.
And like you
and
hear
a quote
his voice
of John Rhys-Davies playing while looking at the stars. It's like the dude is like inside the building.
He's in the other hallway over there.
It's like you'll never be alone with the stars up there.
But you don't need to be
in
alone.
The other room.
He's there. He's right there. He can go inside.
Yeah, it's This movie doesn't make any sense.
It's so.
It's a lot of like our body language implies this, but and our tone implies this, but what we do is the opposite,
right?
Kind of thing. It's like, I want you to be here, I want you to be here, but I don't, or you're not here, but get away from me. It's like, make up your mind.
I can't.
Scorcher.
I recommend it. This will be the third time, probably.
If you like Dante's Peak, The Beach, and Daylight.
If you love Mark Dacascos, watch it, because...
Yeah, it's classic.
Classic docs. Dacascos.
You guys look so tired.
Yeah, I'm going to fall asleep in a minute.
It was a long night last night.
Yeah, I went to bed at like 3 a.m., got up at 7, so I'm like, great. I'm wonderful.
Well, Kathy, thank you for watching Scorcher with us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, we don't usually have women. Occasion. I mean,
yeah, you're lucky.
You're lucky that we
Couch
gave you...
yourself lucky.
Oh, I do.
Because if this was the Scorcher universe, you wouldn't get a mic.
I know. Absolutely not. I wouldn't even have a name.
Yeah. You just
would have been, if you were the guest on the show, you just would have been the table the mics are set on, basically.
So, and some sushi too, you know. Like,
make some sushi.
It's got to be erotic as well.
Well, what's the point of having a woman around? Otherwise, what's the name of that company?
What company?
The produce it.
Oh, the Lewis Horowitz Foundation.
Love these guys.
All right,
financer of such quality films as The Karate Dog.
Dude, these guys are geniuses and not.
I'm pretty sure we're
going to
be
all.
Doing Karate Dog on bonus disc.
You have to.
We're going to.
I really want to watch that, man.
Yeah.
That clip was fucking crazy as hell.
Starring Academy Award winner John Boyd.
And the voice of Chevy Chase.
And the voice of Chevy Chase. All right. That's enough. Scorcher.
Watch it. It's on Netflix.
Netflix, yeah. I got nothing else. I'm so sleepy.
Yeah, I know.
But I'm sleepy from the movie.
It's because the whole movie's sad music.
Yeah.
And people staring
at it's either
at
patriotic
stuff.
Or sad, so it's like you're pulling my emotions here. All right, bye.
You have just listened to Bonus Disc. Questions, comments, and movie suggestions can be posted to facebook.com/bonusdisc. Opinions and criticisms of the hosts and guests of Bonus Disc are 100% valid because they sit high atop Judgment Mountain. So quit your whining.